So this section, this lecture is about how to collect your data, your soil data. You are all soil scientists working on soil, okay. Well, these are the topics, maybe too many. We will see how far we can get. I will first talk a bit about what we call geometric sampling design, think of regular grids, and then a bit about model-based sampling, in which case you use a model of the spatial variation, a variogram, let me say, to optimize your sample. If there is time, I would like to tell a bit about Latin hypercube sampling, a very popular design. And then the final topic, I think that's quite important, I will go into that for sure. That is how to validate your maps. So first about geometric sampling designs. Well, the most simple example of a geometric sampling design is a grid, a regular grid. And this is an example. This is a square grid. Square grid covering, in this case, Ethiopia. Let me say, those parts of Ethiopia that are used for agriculture, the most productive parts of Ethiopia. Well, and I would say this is already quite a good sampling design for mapping. It's not too bad. So now you know how to do it. I think it's not too bad because, well, you cover all parts of Ethiopia. You do not miss some parts. Everywhere there is a point. And so if you want to make your map by spatial interpolation, then it's important that it covers the area. But as we will see, it can be improved. Because, well, there are some small areas which are not covered by points. For instance, over here, you do not have a point and so on. It can be improved a little bit. Why is this regular grid sampling so popular? Well, it's very easy to implement in practice. It has, I would say, a fair spatial coverage. So the spreading is okay, the geographical spreading. Also, I would like to stress there is no need that you place your grid randomly on the area. You can place it where you like it the best, so that the coverage is as good as possible. And there need not be a random start for something. And the orientation, there's no need for making the orientation randomly. Popular shapes are the square, triangular, or hexagonal. So we also have to decide on the spacing of the grid. So that's the distance between neighboring points. How to decide on that? Well, in practice, you often have a limited budget of money. So in that case, you can start the reasoning. You start from this budget, and then if you have a simple cost model in with saying that each point collecting the soil data at one point costs, let me say, 200 euros or another amount, then you can compute the number of points you can afford for the budget. And so that's N, the affordable sample size. Sample size is a technical word. Maybe this, the size of the sample is the number of sampling points. So then you know how many sampling points can I afford for the budget. And then for a square grid, you can use this simple equation to compute the spacing of the square grid. Yeah? By the way, do you have this presentation yourself already? Or you can download it. Bas will tell you. There is another, the other way around is that you do not start from the budget, but you start from a constraint on the precision of the map. Yeah? Let me say, for instance, the maximum interpolation error, the maximum prediction error. But in that case, you do need a model of the spatial variation, a variogram. So then this becomes already a model-based sampling. And so I will come to that later. Yeah? By the way, if there are questions about the theory, please ask me. I'm not disturbed at all by your questions. I'm happy with your questions. Yeah? So the next topic is spatial coverage sampling. It's also a geometric sampling design. So in regular grid sampling, the spatial pattern of the sampling locations is fixed. Yeah? It's a square or a triangle. Yeah? But with irregular shaped areas, yeah, like we had in Ethiopia, the spatial coverage is not optimal. It can be improved. And this suboptimal spatial coverage becomes even more serious when you already have some sampling points, some legacy data. And then in that case you want to fill in the empty areas. You do not want to have a new point close to an existing point. Yeah, to illustrate this, this is an agricultural field here in the Netherlands, and showing a square grid. At least on my screen it's square, it's not entirely square here. But this map shows the Krieging variance. You all know what the Krieging variance is? Yeah? Nice. So the Krieging variance is of course zero at the sampling points. Yeah? And it's the largest at the centers of the square cells. But what you can also see is that you have a large area here with red colors, and this is an area with large Krieging variances. So you are very uncertain, relatively uncertain over here. And the reason is that, well, these points are quite distant from the sampling points. You can decrease the Krieging variance over here by shifting, for instance, this point a little bit in that direction. I do not really like this constraint that the sampling points are on a square grid. I would like to get rid of this constraint. Yeah? There is no need for that, especially in modern times when we have GPS and we can locate our sampling points very easily with GPS. Yeah? In the past, it was very convenient to have them on straight lines, on a square grid. Yeah, but that's not an advantage now anymore, I would say. So the conclusion is that there is no need for this constraint anymore, and I think we can improve a little bit the spatial pattern of the locations by shifting the points, for instance this point, a little bit in that direction. So, and then you get this sample. This is a spatial coverage sample. And as you can see, it's not a square grid anymore. There's some irregularity in it. But this map shows again the Krieging variance. On average, I'm sure that on average, the Krieging variance of this map is smaller compared to the previous map. Yeah? So indeed, we have a point over here. Still, we have this border effect that is very well known, because we do not have points on the other side of the border of the field. There are no sampling points over here, and that explains that you will always have a little bit larger Krieging variances near the border of the field. So the question is how to compute this spatial coverage sample. So what is a spatial coverage sample or infill sample if you already have data, legacy point data? then you want to fill in the empty spaces. So in that case, a given number of sampling points, you first have to decide on the number of sampling points. Yeah? The small n is the sample size. So given this sample size, the locations are optimally spread throughout the study area. And that's done by optimizing a criterion. And this criterion is defined in terms of the distance between what I call here the prediction points, the points where you want to predict your soil property. So in general, these are the nodes of a very fine grid. Yeah? The distance between the prediction points and the nearest sampling point. So this is an example, and this is the criterion that I minimized, the mean squared shortest distance. The mean squared shortest distance is defined as the average over all capital N prediction points. So capital N are the number of nodes of the fine grid, the interpolation grid. Yeah? And for each node of this grid, you compute the distance to the nearest sampling point. Yeah? And you square this distance. So this is for minimum, the shortest distance to a sampling point. Yeah? And this is done for all nodes of the grid. So for all nodes of the grid, you compute the squared distance to the nearest sampling point, and you sum them. And you can divide it by n, but that's not really needed. Then if you would delete this, then you get the sum of the squared shortest distance. And you minimize that sum or the mean of the sum. And this minimization that can be done by a very well-known algorithm called the k-means clustering algorithm. I will come to that later. And this is implemented in an R package written by a colleague of mine, Dennis Walvoort. And you can, this is available on CREN. We will use it this in an exercise. The nice thing of this spatial coverage sampling is that you do not need a variogram for optimizing your sampling locations. So it's not a model-based sampling design, because you minimize a geometric criterion, a criterion defined in terms of distances. So and that's why, because the criterion is defined in terms of distances, not in terms of variances, that's why you do not need a variogram. Is this clear? Yeah. So a very simple example. This is our study area. It's a square. It looks like a rectangle on the screen, but here it's a square. So I have a question. I can afford four sampling points, only four. That's not too much for mapping, I would say, but okay. 4 points. Where are the four points that optimally cover this square? Do you have any idea?
Maybe if you draw that another square, which is half of it, yeah, and then on the vertices.
Draw another square?
Yeah, yeah? The vertices of the smallest square.
How many small squares do you have?
Four.
Four small. Well, let's continue. What do you think of this? Does this?
No.
It's not optimal, I would say. No. I think you are in the right direction. Yeah, very good. What about this one?
No.
Is it better than the first one?
Yes.
Yeah. But it's not optimal. Why not? Why is this not optimal? They should be shifted a bit more to the middle.
Yes.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah, too far into the corners. Yeah. What about this one?
Yeah.
Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree. Yeah. So we split it into four subsquares, equal area, and then we take the centers. So now we know the solution. And let's see whether this algorithm, this k-means algorithm, is able to find this optimal solution. It's always good to know where the optimal solution is, the best spatial coverage sample. How does this work? Well, what you do, what this k-means algorithm does is, you start with selecting randomly 4 points, fully randomly. So these are 4 points I selected fully randomly, a simple random sampling. And then these pixels, they are clustered. It's a clustering algorithm. And how do you cluster these algorithms? For each pixel, you compute the distance from the center to the sampling points. So the distance from this pixel to this point, from this pixel to that point, and so on and so on. And then you determine which sampling point is closest. So this pixel is closest to this point, and this pixel is also closest to that point. So then you get clusters of pixels. Yeah? So all these pink pixels are closest to this point. All these light blue pixels are close to that point, green pixels, so and so purple to this one. So now we have clusters of pixels. And the next step, you compute the center of the clusters. So then this is the center of this cluster. This one, of this green, and so on and so on. So now we have new sampling locations. They are shifted a little bit. And then you iterate this clustering and computing the centers of the clusters. So in the next step, you recompute your clusters. Then you get these clusters. Then you recompute your centers. And so on and so on. So here we are. So it was successful. Simple, isn't it? I like its simplicity. I'm always looking for nice, simple solutions. Yeah, and I think this is a very nice, simple solution.
Did you try recomputing this?
Did I try what?
Recomputing this.
Recomputing it again?
Yeah. Did you try that?
Yeah, but now it stops.
Did you stop or the system stops?
The system stops. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Because it can, it doesn't change anymore. Yeah. Because, well, the next step would be computing clusters. But then you will get the same clusters. So it doesn't change anymore. Yeah. Good question. So this is a spatial coverage sample for Ethiopia, again. And if you would compare this with the square grid, then this spatial coverage has improved compared to the square grid. So it can also be computed for irregular areas, not only for square areas. Yeah, not that common, I would say. Yeah? Yeah, so you can see the size of the pixels a little bit, very small pixels. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the finer the tessellation, as you call it, the more computing time you need. Yeah. Here an other example, we already have one sampling point over here. And now we want to add three more points. Where are these 3 points that optimally fill in the empty area? Well, I would say the new point will not be in the neighborhood of this point. It will not be here. because you already have one here. Yeah? So how does this work? Here we have the existing points, and then I selected randomly three more points. I compute clusters, and then I recompute centers except for this one. This one, we cannot shift this point because it's already sampled. Yeah? But for the rest, it's exactly the same. Yeah? So this point is a little bit shifted in the western direction, and so on and so on. Let's see what we get at the end. So this is a spatial infill sample, and indeed they are far away, they keep away from this existing point. This only makes sense, of course, if we can assume that the soil property did not change here. For if you have a very dynamic soil property, maybe it's not a good idea to use it in mapping. And in that case, I would ignore that point maybe, or you have to update it. I think there is no reason for using other distances in this case. So this is an example of a spatial infill sample of three administrative units in Ethiopia, in which we already had quite a few sampling points. But as you can see, all these sampling points are along the roads. These are roads. Yeah? This is what we call convenience sampling. It's very convenient to sample the soil over there. Yeah? It doesn't take too much time. And these areas are quite remote, of course. And if there are no roads, and takes a lot of time. But you can imagine that this existing sample is not a very suitable sample for mapping by spatial interpolation. And for that reason, I designed a new sampling scheme by this spatial infill sampling. These are the dots on the map, and as you can see, they are all in the empty areas. Over here you already have quite a few sampling points covering this part, but there are still a few more over there. Yeah? You can read about this sampling technique in this paper. Yes?
So the point should be exactly in the center of each strata as before now?
Yes, that's a good point. They are, these are clusters.
Yeah.
And the sampling point is in the center of the cluster.
Inaccessible. There is no way.
Yeah.
To
then, if it's not accessible, then I would shift it a bit. Oh. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So for mapping, that's not really a sin, let me say. If you shift your sampling locations a bit in random sampling, probability sampling, that's not a good idea. Then I'm much more strict. So I will come to that later in the final part of this lecture. Then we will talk about random sampling for validation. And if you have selected a point which is not accessible, then it's not a good idea to shift it to a neighboring location which is accessible. Then this sampling location is cancelled. And then you have to select some extra locations randomly, and then you go to one of these, to the first location on the reserve list. Yeah. But for mapping, there is no randomness in the sampling. We do not use the the randomness in the sampling. So in that case, it's not too dangerous, I would say, to if you shift your locations a bit to neighboring locations. So this is a real-world example. It was from one of my students. He was from Tanzania, and he had this problem, and I would like to show you as an example. So he wanted to map soil hydraulic properties in a watershed in Tanzania near a very nice national park, and he could afford 100 locations again with measurements of soil texture. He wanted to map soil hydraulic properties, but soil texture is related, and it's more cheap to measure soil texture compared to all these laboratory measurements on these soil hydraulic properties. Yeah? But at all 100 locations, he could afford to measure soil texture. And then for a subsample, for 50 points out of the 100, he could afford to collect soil samples into the laboratory and measure the soil hydraulic properties. Yeah? And so then he asked me, well, where to sample the soil for the soil texture measurements. Eh? So you have 50 locations at which you collect soil samples where you measure both soil texture and the soil hydraulic properties, and you can use these measurements to calibrate the regression model. Yeah? And at 50 more locations, you measure only soil texture. Yeah? So at these locations, once you have the model, you can predict the soil hydraulic properties. Yeah? And then at the end, you have 100 measurements of soil hydraulic properties. 50 of them are really measurements. At the other 50 locations, these are predictions from a regression model. So any idea about how to do this? It's a mapping. It's a sampling. A sample for mapping. He wants to make a map. Yeah? So I think these locations should be spread very well throughout the area, because he wants to make a map by spatial interpolation, by kriging, let me say. And I was thinking immediately of a spatial coverage sample. But also the subsample where you measure the soil hydraulic properties, they should also be spread throughout the area. Yeah? So also these 50 points, they should not be all of them in only a small part of the study region. Because then, well, I do not really trust the regression model. Yeah? The regression model should be representative for the whole area. Yeah? So how to do this? Well, I would say this is the first option. This is the study area. And I computed 50 clusters. Yeah? And then I selected in each of these 50 strata randomly 2 points. Yeah? So I did not select now the center, but I selected randomly 2 points. That can be done with the same function, sample. As in our script, we use the function sample. But if you say n is 1 or n is 2, then it selects randomly a point from a cluster. If you do not use the argument n, then it will select the center. Yeah. But so in this case, I said n is 2. I use the argument n, so then it knows, oh, I have to select randomly. How many? Well, 2 in this case. And then at one point, for instance, the triangles, I measure both soil texture and the soil hydraulic properties. And at the other point, I measure only soil texture. So then I have 50 points, the 50 triangles. They cover the whole area, which I can use to calibrate the regression model. And then I can use this regression model to predict at the circles. And then at the end, I have, let me say, 100 measurements or predictions of the soil hydraulic properties. And I can use them in mapping. Yeah?
is there a minimum distance?
No.
No, no. It is, no. Actually, it's determined by the, you will never select two points two times, the same point two times. So it's within the strata, it's simple random sampling without replacement. But the minimum distance, it will be determined by the discretization of the grid. Yeah. So that's a good question because, well, in this case, these two points are pretty close. So I do not think that this is really the best option. I could think of a slightly better option. That's the next slide. Now I computed 100 of these clusters and I selected the center of all these 100 clusters. And then in the next step, I computed pairs of these clusters based on their distance. So over here, these two, on the previous slide, these were two clusters, but they are collapsed, we call it collapsing. Yeah? And then one of the points, at one of the points you measure both properties, and at the other point only soil texture. So in this case, you avoid this, that you have two points very close together. Yeah? So here is an extra step in which you collapse the clusters, to collapse the strata. That cannot be done by this package SP-COSA. Yeah? So this is an example, a real world example. So I would like to continue now with model-based sampling. Until now, we were talking about geometric designs in which you use a geometric criterion in case of spatial coverage sampling. A geometric criterion defined in terms of distances was minimized. Now we will minimize a criterion defined in terms of variance, not in terms of distance. But that requires that you should have an idea about the variogram. If you do not have any idea about the variogram, then you cannot optimize your sample using this model. You do not have the data yet, but well, maybe you have some data from other areas which are more or less similar. Or in some other way, you have, in many cases, you have some idea about the variogram. Let me say the sill, the variance, and the range. Yeah. So in this case, the criterion is defined in terms of the prediction error. For instance, the variance of the prediction error, the Krieging, in case of Krieging, the Krieging variance. And the most important thing is, and I hope that you all know, is that this Krieging variance, so the variance of the prediction error in case of Krieging, is independent of the measurements at the sampling locations. Did you all know that? So if you have a sample and if you change your measurements, then it will not change the Krieging variance. It's fully determined that, let me say, by the spatial pattern of the sampling locations, where they are, the spatial configuration, and the prediction point. The values, the measurements, they do not play any role. And that's a nice thing, of course. Why is this important? Why is this a nice thing? Suppose that they were dependent, that the Krieg invariance is dependent of the measurements. How about optimization of the sampling design? Yeah, then you need the sample to optimize. Then it cannot be done. But we are lucky, the Krieg invariance is independent of it. So for that reason, we are able to search for the locations so that the Krieg invariance is minimized. I hope you understand. There are two topics here. The first topic is sampling on a square grid. And I already talked about how to decide on the spacing of the grid. You can start from the budget. You say, I can afford 163 points, so then the spacing of the square grid should be, let me say, 72 meters, and with this spacing I get indeed 136 points. Yeah? But you can also say, I want to control the Krieg invariance. We are searching for the spacing of the grid so that the Krieg invariance at the center of the square cells does not exceed some threshold value. Yeah? So that's the first topic. And the second, so in this case we are optimizing the spacing of the grid given a requirement on the Krieg invariance at the center of the square cells. Yeah? Where it is maximal. And the other topic is, then we are really searching for the optimal locations. So then in that case, the locations will not be anymore on a square grid. They can be anywhere. You will get an irregular pattern, similar to the spatial coverage sample. But then you use the model to search for these optimal locations. Yeah. Let's first go into the first topic. So I will consider the case in which there is no trend. You do not have any covariates, and no spatial trend, and no covariates. In that case, you will interpolate by ordinary Krieging. Yeah, not by Krieging with an external, not by regression Krieging, as you call it here. Yeah. Given the variogram, given your variogram, so you choose some variogram, then the Krieg invariance is fully determined by the spatial configuration of the sampling points and the prediction point. Yeah? Measurements do not play any role. And for regular grids, for instance square grids, the Krieg invariance is maximal at the center of a cell. And I will ignore the border effects. As we saw on one of my first slides, that near the edge of the area, the Krieg invariance increases because you do not have measurements at the other side of the border. But I will ignore that. I will simply look if these are the 4 points, sampling points. I will look at the Krieg invariance over here. The distance to the sampling points is the largest over there, so the Krieg invariance will be also the largest over there. So this is again the square grid, and ignoring the border effect, the Krieg invariance is the largest over here. So we will say we do not allow the Krieg invariance over here to exceed some threshold. How large can the spacing of the grid be? So what's the procedure? You have to specify a variogram type, for instance, a spherical model, exponential model, and the parameters of the model, yeah, based on your prior knowledge. Then, this is the procedure for R. This is implemented in one of the R scripts you have. Then you construct a data frame with the coordinates of a square grid with a given spacing, and you add a dummy variable to this data frame. This dummy variable is not important. You simply add a column with all ones, for instance. Yeah? And then you predict the dummy variable at the center of the grid by ordinary kriging. Well, the predicted value will all, in this case, if your dummy variable has all value 1, then the predicted value will also be 1. But that's not important. We are not interested in the predicted value. We are interested in the kriging variance. Yeah? And the kriging variance will not be 1. It will be determined by the spacing of the grid and by the variogram, of course. Yeah? And you save the kriging variance. And then you repeat this for other grid spaces in a for loop. Yeah, you start with a very fine grid and then you make it a bit larger and so on and so on. And every time you predict the dummy variable at the center of the grid and you save the kriging variance. And then you make a plot with on the x-axis the spacing of the grid and on the y-axis the kriging variance. And then you will see that it will increase. And then you say, well, I do not want to that it exceeds some threshold value. And then you draw a horizontal line at that level. And then you can see what grid spacing. I will show you. So this is an example. This is this convenience sample in Ethiopia. I use this. And this, I am, of course, here I have a lot of prior knowledge. I can use all these data to compute a variogram. And that's what I did. These are sologenic carbon data. And I computed a variogram. It's this variogram, very large nugget. About 50% of the total variation is pure nugget or very short range variation. And then you have structured variance with a range of about 50 kilometers, so that's quite a distance. There is some spatial structure. Well, I use this fitted model, a spherical model, to optimize the grid spacing. As said, I have chosen a spacing of 1 kilometer, 1.5, 2, 2.5, and so on. And for every spacing, I computed the kriging variance at the center of a grid cell. And as you can see, it increases and increases. And then you say, well, I do not want to that the kriging variance exceeds, for instance, 0.7. That's over here. Then you draw a horizontal line. And then you conclude that the grid spacing may not exceed 2.2 kilometer. If it becomes wider, if you have a grid with a spacing of 3 kilometer, then the kriging variance at the center of the cells will be larger. Very simple, isn't it? I'm happy that you agree. So there is an exercise. So the next topic is the optimization of the locations of your sampling points and the coordinates, as we did in spatial coverage sampling. Using now a model of the spatial variation, a variogram. So we will not minimize a geometric criterion defined in terms of distances, but we will minimize a criterion in terms of variances, prediction error variances, kriging variances. So again, given the sample size, given the number of sampling locations, so in one way or another you have decided on how many locations you want to sample, and now you want to compute the optimal locations. Have we minimized some criterion again? But now this criterion is defined in terms of the prediction error variance. For instance, let's take the mean kriging variance. So the average of the Krieging variances for all prediction nodes. You Krieg to a fine grid, you compute the Krieging variance for every node of the grid, and you compute the average. And we want to minimize this average, this mean Krieging variance. And first remark is that we cannot use k-means anymore to optimize these locations. K-means is, in that sense, not very flexible. It can only minimize this mean squared shortest distance, leading to a spatial coverage sample. It cannot be used to minimize the mean Krieging variance. So we need a different algorithm. And a very popular algorithm is named spatial simulated annealing, the spatial version of simulated annealing. It is described in this paper of Van Groeningen et al. He's also a colleague of mine here in Wageningen. A long time ago, he also worked on sampling. He's not in parametrics anymore. That's a pity. But together with Alfred Stein, he's a professor here, and they were the first time who applied this simulated annealing. It's developed not in soil science, it's developed in physics. But they discovered that they can use it for optimization of spatial samples. So that was a very good idea. And how does it work? I will explain very shortly, so that you have an idea. So in simulated annealing, a new pattern of sampling points is generated by slightly distorting, changing the previous pattern. So let's, for instance, select our first sample by fully random sampling. You have a fully random sample. Then you pick out one of the points and you shift it a little bit. Then it's distorted. Your first sample is changed a little bit. And your mean Krieging variance, your criterion, is evaluated, is computed for every new sample, every new pattern. And if it's improved, if the mean Krieging variance of the new sample is smaller compared to the previous sample, then you are happy, of course, because you want to minimize it. And then you say, well, I accept this one because it's better, it's improved. But the typical thing of simulated annealing is that if this mean Krieging variance is slightly larger, it increases, then you are not very happy, but still then you accept it with some given probability. So you also accept worse samples, samples with a mean Krieging variance that is slightly larger compared to your previous sample. Why do you think it's important to accept also worse samples? Do you have any idea? You're going in the wrong direction. You want to minimize it.
At least we need to know that.
Sorry? Sorry? Alternative. You mean that it's...
I just answer your question.
Oh, yeah, but I do not understand your question, your answer.
It means that you have some...
So let me... So you have some sample, now you pick out one point and you shift it a little bit, and then the mean Krieging variance increases. That's not what you would like. You want to minimize it. But then there should be a probability that you accept it. You do not always accept it, but in some cases you accept it. Now, why is this important?
To maybe some tracks.
Sorry?
Track. I mean, non-co-optimization. So, for example, you have two ways. You can, you go a good way.
Right.
You cannot go to the high.
Yes. Suppose you are walking, that's exactly the answer. So suppose that you are walking in the mountains and you want to go to the point with the lowest elevation. Yeah? Then then you should also accept that you have to climb a mountain in order to find the location with the smallest elevation. I have a blackboard here, or a whiteboard. So this is a mountainous area. This is the deep. We want to find this point. Yeah? And suppose we are here. Yeah? Well, I will never find this point if I do not accept worse results. I should be able to climb this one. Otherwise, if I only accept improvements, then I will end up here, which is higher compared to the location over here. So this is what we call a local optimum or a local minimum. This is the global minimum, the global optimum. So that's why in simulated annealing, you also accept intermediate worse results. Is this clear? So suppose the mean creaking variance of a new sample, a proposal sample, we call it, you propose a new sample, is 0.1 larger than for an existing sample. And for another proposal sample, it is 0.05 larger. So it's half of it. Should the probability of acceptance be equal? What do you think? Or doesn't, would you say, well, it doesn't matter? I would say, in this case, I would like to have a smaller probability of accepting it compared to if it increases by 0.05, because this is really a worse result compared to this one. So this probability, I would say, should be a function of how much it becomes worse, how much the mean creaking variance increases. And that's actually what is done. So the probability that worse results, worse samples are accepted is a function of how much worse is it. And the larger the increase, the smaller the probability that you accept it. And besides that, it's also a function of how many iterations you already did. In the beginning of the optimization, the probability of accepting worse samples is large compared to the end. If you are at the end of the optimization, you really do not like to accept worse results anymore, because then, in general, then you are already very near to the global minimum. Yeah. So it's also a function of the number of iterations you already did. To illustrate it, I will illustrate it with a simple example: a square area. Study area is square, and I selected. This is, I think, a spatial coverage sample I computed with this SP-COSA, and the mean creaking variance for this sample is 1.6342. Now I select randomly one point. Yeah. I select this point, fully randomly. And then I shift it in a random direction by also a random distance. So this one is shifted to this location. So this is my new sample. Yeah, this point is shifted to this location, and then I compute the Krieging, mean Krieging variance again. Yeah, and then I get this number. And if you would compare this number with the previous one, then you will see that it's slightly larger. 1.64278. So it's slightly larger. So this is a worse result. But that the probability that I accept it is, let me say, 0.7. Yeah? So let's see what happened. There's a probability of 0.7 that I accept it. Yes, I accepted it. Yeah? Because it shifted. Then I select fully randomly a second point. Then by chance I select this stupid, but I selected this one. Shifted it again. It was shifted in this direction. And then I compute the mean Krieging variance again. Then it will be slightly better, I would say. Eh? That's my guess. That's true. This number is slightly smaller. It was 7.8, it's now 7.6. So I always accept if it's improved. If it's small, if it becomes smaller, so this one will be accepted. Yeah, and so on and so on. So then I selected this point, it shifted to this point. Well, then it will be worse, and then I accept it with a probability of 0.23. Let's see. Oh, I bad luck. I accepted it, so it shifted. Was only a probability of 0.23, but I had bad luck. So I always have bad luck. But so and so on. And then at the end, you will find this. So this is the sample with a mean Krieging variance, which is minimal, or let me say nearly minimal. Yeah, this is how simulated annealing works. Are there questions about simulated annealing? Yeah? No, no questions.
You can also use it to thin the network, right? To remove point
yeah.
Given a threshold is acceptable.
If you have
less fun for monitoring
network. So, but in that case, I do not really know whether you need simulated annealing, because then you might try out all possibilities, maybe. It depends on how large your sample is, and
there
so
are
on.
Rather than another one.
So, yeah, I do not know whether you need a random search method in your case, but maybe, yeah, and then this can be done, yeah? Like this. So, simulated annealing is a very flexible algorithm because you can minimize any criterion. Also for this Latin hypercube sampling, in the software developed by Budiman Minasny and Alex McBratney, they use simulated annealing. But they minimized a totally different criterion, not the mean Krieging variance, but some other criterion. You can define your own criterion and minimize it by simulated annealing. Yeah? You can even minimize the mean squared shortest distance by simulated annealing. I would not do that because there is no need for that. But it can be done. How do you define
when to stop this algorithm?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Yeah. There is some stopping criteria.
Yeah.
I forgot, but. But my guess is that it is defined. This was rather complicated. Yeah. The number of proposed samples that is not accepted anymore, in terms something like that. It was rather. You can think of many stopping criteria. One of the things is that if you propose a new sample, it's not accepted because it's worse. Yeah? And if this happens, for instance, 1,000 times, Well, then maybe it's better to stop, because apparently you cannot find any other samples anymore that are better. And number of accepted samples. Yeah. One more remark. In my experience, simulated annealing, you need some exercise, because there are some. You have to choose some parameters, parameters which determine, for instance, the probability of accepting worse samples. It's called cooling schedule, and so on and so on. And it is a little bit a craft, let me say, to design a sample with simulated annealing. But on the other hand, it is very flexible. So there are some good things, there are some difficult things, let me say. As you can see, I'm not entirely convinced that this is really the best sample, because there is some strange irregularity in it. For instance, this point over there, it's a bit. But well, the coverage is not too bad. By the way, I compared the samples obtained by simulated annealing, minimizing the mean Krieging variance, with the samples obtained by spatial. By minimizing the mean squared shortest distance, the spatial coverage sample, they were very similar. And the mean Krieging variance of the spatial coverage sample was very close to the mean Krieging variance obtained by minimizing it using the simulated annealing algorithm. So if you do not have, for this you need a variogram, if you do not have a variogram, and if you compute a spatial coverage sample by this Espicosa, don't worry too much, it will be very close to this one. Yeah? So then I continue with Latin hypercube sampling. That's an entirely different sampling design. First, a bit about the origin of Latin hypercube sampling. Actually, Latin hypercube sampling is used in designing experiments. So, for instance, experiments on agricultural experiments. Experiments in which you have numerous covariates or treatments. Think, for instance, of an experiment in which you have two covariates, that's not numerous, but let's keep it simple, two covariates, the application rates for nitrogen and phosphorus, and with four levels for each treatment. So four application rates of nitrogen and four application rates of phosphorus. Yeah? The best option is, of course, to have multiple plots, experimental plots, for all 4x4 combinations. So you have 16 combinations. Well, and then for each combination you want to have some replicates. Let me say 2 or 3 or 4 or 5. And then this increases and this increases. It becomes quite an expensive experiment. And if you have numerous covariates, not only two, nitrogen and phosphorus, but also sulfur or anything, other treatments, and many levels per covariate, then this becomes infeasible, too expensive. So this is what we call a full factorial experimental design, in which you try out all combinations, two treatments, four levels, and you try out all of them. But in the Latin hypercube sample, it looks like this. So we have 16 combinations over here, and I have only 4 here. But for each level of each covariate, there is at least 1. Yeah, in every column you have one point, and in every row you have one point. So this is a Latin hypercube experiment. Yeah? Yeah?
Why would that be optimal for agronomy?
Sorry?
It seems that that would not be optimal for agronomy, because you would be better off with the replicated experiment.
Yes.
Than the beginning.
Yeah, of course, you are better off, yes. You have more information. Yeah, but it's more, bit more expensive. Yeah. Yeah.
I think you'd get ambiguous results with this for agronomy.
Sorry, you get?
You wouldn't have clear results, I don't think.
Oh, yeah.
With this, if you have multiple treatments and you're doing them all at one time.
Well, I to be honest, I do not have any experience with analyzing data from Latin hypercube experiments. So that's what actually that's what you're wondering. How does this work? Yeah? But I cannot answer your question. I only have experience with Latin hypercube sample in observational studies, as I will explain now later on. Yeah, and this can be analyzed perfectly. Yeah. So this experimental design, it was adapted a bit by Budiman and Nasny for observational studies. Yeah. And I think this Latin hypercube sampling is especially suitable if you want to make your map by classification and regression trees, yeah, or random forest or cubist. So I'm not talking anymore so much about spatial interpolation, and I think this Latin hypercube, you can use Latin hypercube samples for kriging, of course you can, yeah, but I'm not sure whether this is optimal. Yeah. For regression kriging, okay, yeah, but I think especially suitable if you are thinking of making your map by random forests or cubists. Have you ever heard of random forests?
Yep.
Yeah, it's very popular. Yeah? So in that case, if you say, well, I would like to make my map by random forests, and now I have to collect my data, well, think of Latin hypercube sampling. And I will explain why. For if you want to map by random forests, then it's important that for each covariate you have the full range of values, not only very small values and very large values, but also intermediate values, the full range of values. Yeah?
How can you know that in advance that you're 100% sure?
Well, you have your maps of your covariates. Yes. Yeah. Not the range of the
target.
No, of course you do not know. Yeah. Of the covariates. That's important. Yeah. Yeah. This is very important to cover the full range of the covariate values, because if you remember how this works, it's random forest, you have these splitting values. Yeah? And these, you do not know where they are. Yeah? They can be anywhere, the values of the splitting variable. Yeah? And if you do not know where they are, well, then it's important to have the full coverage so that you can find the optimal splitting value, the best splitting value. Yeah? How does it work? This Latin hypercube sampling, for each covariate a series of intervals is defined, and the numbers of pixels in the intervals are equal. I will show you some slides in which this becomes more clear maybe than this sentence. And the intervals, they serve as strata, or also referred to as the marginal strata. And the thing is, if you have many covariates and all these marginal strata, not all combinations of these marginal strata can be sampled anymore. Similar to this experiment, you cannot afford to have a trial for each combination of the covariate levels. The same here, you cannot afford to sample all combinations of the marginal strata. I will explain. I will try to make this more clear with a case study in Australia, Hunter Valley. It's a good wine area in New South Wales. And well, I used four covariates: wetness index, slope, potassium, elevation. And I designed a Latin hypercube sample of 50 points. Yeah, these are the maps of the covariates: wetness index, slope, elevation, and radiation of potassium. And well, this slide shows the scatter plot of wetness versus slope. And I said 50 points, but this slide is about selecting 4 points. Yeah? So 50 has been changed to 4 now. What you do is then you, as I said, you for each covariate you define a series of intervals. Yeah? And the number of pixels in each interval should be the same. Yeah? So this is your first interval for wetness index. The upper bound is slightly smaller than 9. Yeah? And then the second interval goes from this value to that value. The third interval goes from here to here. Fourth interval from here to here. Oh, so 5, I want to select 5 points in this case, sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So then I have 5 intervals for each covariate. And we are computing these values so that the number of pixels in each interval is the same. These are the pixels, eh? So actually this means that, sorry, this is a scatter plot of wetness versus slope for all pixels in the area. I showed you on the previous slide the covariates. These were pixel maps. Yeah? And so the number of pixels in each interval is the same. And that actually means that you compute quantiles of the frequency distribution. These are quantiles. Yeah? In this case, this is the 20% quantile, 40%, 60%, and 80% quantile. Yeah? The same is done for slope. So again, 5 intervals, yeah? And the number of pixels in these rows, in these stripes, they are the same. Yeah? So, and now we are selecting 5 pixels, 5 of these points, so that in each column we have 1 point, and in each row. That's the principle of Latin hypercube sampling. This is a a map of the Latin hypercube sample of 50 points. So in that case, I would have 49 of these vertical lines, and 49, but that was not really a nice graph, so that's why I changed to 5 over here. And these are the 50 points in the scatter plot. Yeah? Let me see. No, I had that slide, sorry. But if you would have drawn the vertical and horizontal lines, you would have seen that you have in every column and in every row 1 point. Is this a bit clear? Yeah? So this is a slide showing the sample size within each marginal stratum. So these are the marginal strata. Yeah? Marginal means that along one axis. Yeah? I want to have one point in this marginal stratum, in this. So we have in this case 5 plus 5 is 10 marginal strata. Yeah? In this case, I had 4 covariates and 50 points. So I have 4 times 50 is 200 marginal strata. And in each marginal stratum, I want to have one point. And for most marginal strata, this is indeed the case. I subtracted 1. So if it's 0, then I have 1 point. Yeah? And if it's minus 1, I do not have selected a point in that marginal stratum. So that, and if it's 1, then I have selected 2. So this is a very good result, I would say. It's very difficult to find it. And is this clear, this slide? Maybe a bit confusing that I subtracted 1. But if it's 0, then it's okay. So actually these are the deviations from the ideal sample size of 1. Yeah? And so there are a few marginal strata. There are 4 marginal strata. There are 2 in which there are no points, and there are 2 in which there are 2 points. Yeah? So how is this sample computed? This is computed by simulated annealing again. So actually what it does, it starts from a random sample, and then it is distorted a little bit again, and then it computes the criterion, and the criterion is defined in terms of the deviations from the absolute deviations from the ideal sample size. So in this case, the criterion is 4 plus 4 plus 4 plus 4 is 16. Yeah? And we want to have this number as small as possible. If it's 0, then the idea, then and you have 1 point in every marginal stratum. Actually, it's slightly more complicated, because this criterion, there is a second term and even a third term, but this is the most important term. So as I said, in simulated annealing, you can define your criterion as you like it, and then you can minimize it. So then the final topic. What time is it?
4:20.
Oh, we have, I think we will finish before 5:30. But well, okay. No problem with that, I hope. So this is a topic, Bas Kempen. He asked me to talk about this, topic 2. And I agree, it's an important topic, yeah? Because, we like to make maps. Yeah? We all like that, to make maps. Yeah? But a map is more than, I always say, map is more than wallpaper. Yeah? We hope that there is some resemblance with reality. Yeah? And but we want to know how much does it resemble reality? How good is the map? And what's the quality of the map? We cannot stop after we have mapped our soil and say, well, here's the map. As a as a scientist, we are we should tell the users of the map how good the map is. But how to quantify this quality of the map? That's not an easy task. And so we all know that our maps, our digital soil maps, that they are imperfect. One map is more imperfect than the other one, but we want to know how good are these maps, of how imperfect are they. It's a pity that, as Grunwald already said, that too often these digital soil maps, they are not validated. The quality is not quantified. Yeah. There are several methods for validation of the map, for estimating the quality of the map. That is, the most important are the data splitting, cross-validation, and additional sampling. It was not clear to me, at least, when I worked on this topic, what validation strategy is the best. So I will come to that. By the way, this research is published in this paper. I think Bas has also copied this paper. Yeah. Bas is the second or the third. Yeah. Hey. Is this? I think it should Bas Kemp and Heuvelich, but I'm not sure. It is, I think. No. So these maps are imperfect, which means you should make a distinction between quantitative soil maps and qualitative soil maps. On a quantitative soil map, you have a continuous soil property like pH, soil organic carbon, and the predicted pH of soil organic carbon is not equal to the true value. Yeah? And for categorical soil maps, in which you have soil types or suitability classes, the predicted class, the predicted soil type, is not equal to the true soil type. So, in general, we use statistical methods for making our digital soil maps. And if you use a statistical method, why should we why is it attractive to use statistical method? Well, statistical methods, they also produce direct estimates of your predictions. The Krieging variance, for instance. That's why these statistical methods are of interest, I would say. But this Krieging variance, this is what we call an internal accuracy. And this internal estimate of the accuracy of the predictions, they rely on the assumptions that you have made, the modeling assumptions. And one of these modeling assumptions is, for instance, in ordinary Krieging, you assume that the mean and the variance is everywhere the same. Yeah? This is an assumption. And the Krieging variance is only, let me say, correct if this assumption is correct. If the assumption is not correct, then your Krieging variance is not correct. It's not unbiased, let me say. Yeah? So, although you get some statistical methods give you an idea about the uncertainty, you cannot fully rely on them. I always say, use them as a relative measure of your accuracy. At some locations you are more uncertain, you have larger variances, so you are more uncertain compared to other locations. Yeah? But not so much the absolute value. It's better to have an external or test estimate of the accuracy. And this accuracy is based on ground truth data, on real data that are not used for calibration of the model, not used in mapping, let me say. And I think this is to be preferred. A few words about map quality measures. How to quantify the quality of the map? What measures can be used for that? Well, a very simple example. This is our reality. It's a simulated reality obtained by geostatistical simulation. And I sampled on a square grid. It is centered. And then I use the measurements at these points to predict the soil property of interest everywhere. And then you get, by kriging, I did that by kriging, and then you obtain this map. It's much smoother compared to reality. Kriging is the smoother. So the next step is that I computed, I subtracted these two maps. And the predicted value minus the true value for every pixel. And that's the nice thing of simulation, then you know the reality. So I can compute the prediction errors everywhere. And then you can compute a histogram of these prediction of the prediction errors. And as you can see, the prediction, the mean prediction error is close to zero. That's nice, of course. You do not want to have a histogram over here. But there is also a variance of the prediction error. In this case, it's nicely symmetric. In practice, it can be different, of course. So this is the histogram of the prediction errors at all nodes in the area. In reality, you do not know them, of course. You have only a sample where you know the prediction error. But I'm now talking about how to define our quality measures. I talked about, in the previous slide, I had the prediction error. We can do the same for the this is a map of the squared prediction error. So I simply squared every error. So then we get a much more skewed distribution, histogram. And they are always positive. So this is the histogram of the squared errors at all nodes in the area. So in case of quantitative maps, important quality measures are the mean error. It's a measure of the bias. It is defined like this. Capital N are all the pixels in the area. So it's the average over all pixels in the area of the error. So this is the definition of the mean error. And the same, we can do the same for the mean squared error. You simply square this and you compute the average. So I define the mean squared error in this way. And the mean absolute error. So this is the definition. So the mean error is simply the mean in this histogram. And the mean squared error is the mean in this histogram. The mean of the squared errors in the whole population. Yeah? So it's important to realize that this mean error and mean squared error and mean absolute, that these are defined as population means. Means for the entire population, for your entire study area. And we call them also spatial means. Yeah? These true values of the mean error and the mean squared error, they are unknown, of course. They will always be unknown. You never know them precisely, because you do not know the errors and the squared errors for every population unit at every location in your area. Yeah? The best thing you can do is to estimate these means. You want to estimate the mean error or estimate the mean squared error. Yeah? But these estimates, they are not errorless. Yeah? There will be an error in this estimate. Yeah? You will always be uncertain about the true mean error and the true mean squared error. But it's important to realize that these are two different things. The population mean squared error and an estimate of the mean squared error. Yeah. It would be great, of course, if these estimates of the mean, of these means, are unbiased, and if we know the accuracy of these estimated means. Yeah. I would be happy to have an unbiased estimate of the mean squared error and an accurate estimate of the mean squared error, and I would like to know how accurate is this estimate of the mean squared error. Yeah? For instance, for the mean error, I would like to know what's the variance of the mean error. I need this variance to test whether the mean error differs significantly from zero. In other words, is there a bias in the map? I want to test this by statistical testing. And then you need the variance of the estimated mean error. Are there questions about these map quality measures? I will not go into map quality measures for categorical maps. This is a different story. Then I need more time. Then I should talk about purity, overall purity and things like that, map unit purity. It's a bit too much, I would say. Questions about this? Do you understand this distinction between the M what? MAE, mean absolute error.
Absolute.
Yeah. Mean absolute error, mean squared error, mean error. Well, this is sometimes used, this is more important. And you sometimes take the square root of it, so that the root mean squared error, so then you estimate your mean squared error, and then you take the square root of it. So now I would like to comment on these three validation methods. So we had three: data splitting, cross-validation, additional sampling. In data splitting, the data are split into two subsets: one training or calibration subset, subsample, and a testing or validation subsample. Okay. The first set is to calibrate your model. For instance, to estimate your variogram, and you use it for mapping. And the second subset is used for validation of your map. Yeah? This is very common practice in remote sensing. I've seen many papers on that. But the big question is how to split your data so that you obtain unbiased and valid estimates of the map accuracy. That's a very difficult question, I would say. I do not know. Well, these people, I think they do not worry too much about this question, but I'm worried about it. And I do not have an answer to this question. And the thing is that these data for calibration and mapping, they are typically selected by purposive what we call purposive sampling, or targeted sampling. For instance, they selected the locations by spatial coverage sampling, for instance, or Latin hypercube sampling. And these are not random samples, not what I call probability samples. I will come to that later. And it's important that even if you select your subset for validation by selecting randomly from your sample points, then this random subsample is not a probability sample, is not a random sample from the entire population. That's important. To illustrate this, for instance, suppose that you have really a biased sample. Yeah? So that means that the mean in the sample mean differs from the population mean. Think, for instance, of samples collected preferentially at contaminated sites, so where you expect that there will be soil contamination, then the mean of these the concentrations of these contaminants in your sample will be large compared to the population mean. It's because, well, the contaminated sites are overrepresented in your sample. So if you have such a biased sample, and now you select randomly some points, 20 or any number of points out of this biased sample, then there will still be bias in this subsample. It's not a probability sample, a random sample from your entire area. Some people think that, but that's an error. So, and this implies that you cannot estimate this mean error and this mean squared error by what we call design-based estimation. I will come to that later. And the nice thing of design-based estimation is that you do not use a model of the spatial variation. You do not need a variogram. Yeah? But that's not possible if your validation sample is not a probability sample from your area. Then design-based estimation is impossible. Actually, this validation subsample is a non-probability sample, and that means that you must account for possible spatial autocorrelation, spatial structure of your prediction or classification errors. They can be correlated. If you have a positive error at this location, then the prediction error at a nearby location will also be positive on average. Yeah? And you must account for that if you estimate your mean error endure the variance of this mean, especially the variance of this mean error, estimated mean error. Well, so there are problems with data splitting. I do not like data splitting. I cannot recommend it. Then I would prefer the second option, cross-validation. Yeah? And the most prefer leave one out cross-validation. So you all know what leave one out cross-validation is? So you leave out your sampling points one by one. Yeah? And then you predict at this location that you left out. And then you go to the second point, and so on and so on. Yeah? So if you have 100 locations, then you leave them out one by one, and then you predict at these 100 locations. So you get 100 predictions, and you can compare it with the true value at that location because you left it out. Yeah? And then you get 100 prediction errors and 100 squared prediction errors. So I would say that this is more efficient than data splitting, yeah? Because in data splitting, you do not use part of the locations for mapping. Let me say 20% or something. If you have 100 points and you leave out 20%, so 20 points for validation, which is not very much, I would say, then you use only 80 points for mapping. That's a bit of a pity, I would say. So then I would say, well, let's... I prefer leave one out cross-validation. It's more efficient. But the thing is that the problem of these spatially correlated errors, I talked about, that this problem remains when these data are non-probability sample data. Yeah? I will explain later on what non-probability data are. So then, the final option, which is the option I prefer, that is that you collect additional data. You need money for that, but well, I do not have to pay for that. So the problem is that why do I prefer actually why do I prefer to collect additional data? The thing is that the best sample for validation differs from the best sample for calibration and for mapping. This is what Bas said in the introduction. Yeah? And for calibration mapping, purposive sampling is a good option. Think of spatial coverage sampling, like an hypercube sampling. Yeah? If you work
on a global scale,
validation by probability sampling, mm-hmm. Yeah, I would say, no problem with that.
How do you decide your points then in the same way?
How do you decide?
To
select the locations.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there are many options for that. Yeah, I will come to that later a bit, but yeah. Accessibility can be a problem, of course. Yeah, that's maybe you are referring to.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, of course. I think I will talk a bit about it. So, for calibration, in general, let me say, probability sampling is not the first choice. Yeah? As we have seen, maybe it's a good idea to select a spatial coverage sample. There is no randomness in it. Or a Latin hypercube sample, yeah? For mapping. But for validation, the best option is probability sampling. And I will explain why. And because this is different, I think it's not a good idea to use the calibration sample for validation. Why probability sampling for validation? The reason is that if you select your sampling location for validation by probability sampling, then you do not need a model for estimating these map quality measures, like the mean error, mean squared error, and the mean absolute error. Yeah? You can estimate these means, these population means, from your probability sample data without using a model of the spatial variation of the prediction errors. Yeah? It's a model-free estimate of the population mean of the errors, or the squared errors, or the absolute errors. We call it design-based estimation, model-free design-based estimation. And in other words, you obtain model-free, unbiased, and valid estimates of the map quality measures. You can obtain valid estimates of the map quality, and I think that's important for validation. Yeah? So the quality of these estimates of the mean error and the mean squared error, the quality of these estimates, they are not dependent on modeling assumptions, because you do not use a model. So then they are always valid. Yes.
So we can select the validation samples before mapping?
Yeah. Yeah. So, yeah. So but then you do not use them in the mapping.
Design a campaign, I can select my samples for calibration and mapping.
Yeah.
And other samples I know will be used for validation.
Yeah, very good. Yeah, it can be one campaign. Yeah.
Okay.
No problem. There can be an advantage if you do it afterwards. I will show that later on. To design your probability sample, it can be efficient to use your map already.
But then you use the model.
No. So discussions on the validity of the estimated map quality are avoided by this design-based estimation. If you would use a model for estimating the mean squared error, for instance, you creak the errors, or the squared errors, then someone might say, well, I do not like that model that you use for creaking these errors. It's not realistic. And you say, well, I think it's realistic. Then you have a debate, and you want to avoid that debate. And also model-free valid estimates of the variance of the estimates can be obtained. So a bit more about this design-based estimation. This was the topic of my PhD thesis a long time ago. So actually you have two fundamentally different sampling approaches. This is what we call the design-based sampling approach and the model-based sampling approach. And in the design-based sampling approach, the sampling units, in our case, let me say sampling locations, they are selected by probability sampling. They must be selected by probability sampling. And the statistical inference, let me say estimation, is based on the method you used for selecting the locations. It's based on the sampling design. Probability sampling is something like random sampling. I will come to that later. Yeah? In a model-based sampling strategy, there is no requirement on how you select your locations. So you might think that's a good thing. You do not really need to select them by probability sampling. So you can select them by purposive sampling or convenience sampling or probability sampling. You may select them by probability sampling. It's not really needed. and the statistical inference, the estimation of the mean, block rigging, or mapping, is based on a model, model-based inference. So, what is probability sampling? Probability sampling is something like random sampling, but then there are two requirements. All population units, and let me say all locations in your study area, must have a positive probability of being selected. And the second requirement is that the probability that a location is selected, is included in your sample, we also call it inclusion probability, they must be known, because you need these inclusion probabilities in estimating the mean. So, if one of these requirements is not fulfilled, so for instance, if you cannot recover these probabilities that a location is selected, then it's not a probability sample. It's important to be aware that these inclusion probabilities need not be equal. Many people think that they should be equal. That's not true. In many cases, they are not equal, but they must be known. That's the only requirement. For instance, in stratified random sampling, in general, the inclusion probabilities are not the same. Strata with a high sampling density have a larger inclusion probability than strata with a smaller sampling density. So, the term random sampling is commonly used for arbitrary or haphazard sampling. So there is no specific purpose in which for selecting some locations. So it's more or less arbitrary. And then many scientists refer to this as random sampling. But that is not what that's not a probability sample, because for these arbitrary selected locations, you do not know the probability that it's selected. They are not so. And if you do not know these inclusion probabilities, then design-based estimation of the mean error, and the mean squared error is impossible. So I can say that all probability samples are random samples, but not all random samples are probability samples. So random samples is a larger set compared to a probability sample. So I always recommend to use the term probability sampling for random sampling with known inclusion probabilities. So in your papers, if you really selected them by a proper random sampling design so that the inclusion probabilities are known. So you used some random number generator and so on, you did it all properly, or you used an R package in which this is being done properly, then in your papers refer to it as probability sampling, so that if I review that paper, then I know, oh, he did it properly. I have reviewed so many papers in which they say, we selected locations randomly, and then I always wondered, how did they really select them? And then it appeared that it was not a probability sample. So avoid the term random sampling if you, except in terms like stratified random sampling. Well, then that's a, how do you call it? It's a term. You cannot say stratified probability sampling. It's referred to as stratified random sampling and simple random sampling and so on. So a bit confusing maybe what I'm saying now. Sorry. So be careful when reading in scientific literature. Sampling units have been selected randomly. What is precisely meant with randomly? So examples. This is an area here in the Netherlands, not too far from here. It's a study region of the university. From west to east, it's a stripe. And these points are selected by simple random, this is what we call simple random sampling. What is simple random sampling? All locations have an equal probability of being selected, and these locations are selected independently from each other. So once you have selected the first one, then the second one is selected independently from this first one. It can be anywhere. Yeah? That's simple random sampling. I never use it in practice. But this is a reference strategy, I would say. Reference design. This is stratified simple random sampling. So what I did here, I divided my study area into strata, and these strata are combinations of soil type and land use. A is for agriculture, F is for forest, and then these are the soil types. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 strata, sub areas, and in each stratum I selected fully randomly by simple random sampling some points. Yeah, at least 2. So it's stratified. This is much better already in general. This is a systematic random sample. So it's a square grid, but now the grid is randomly placed on the area. So you select one point randomly, and then once you have selected this first point randomly, then all other points can be computed, if you have decided on the orientation and on the spacing. Yeah. This is a very popular random design. It's so popular on that because in this will give you, in general, very precise estimates of the mean, for instance. But there is also a big drawback, and that is there are no unbiased estimators of the variance of the estimated mean. Actually, you do not have replicates here. You have selected only one cluster of points. Yeah? You only selected randomly one point. And then all other points are fixed. So there is no replication in the random selection. So that explains why it's impossible to estimate the variance of the mean. Yeah? But it is still very popular, so, well, I have to mention it. This cluster random sample. So actually these are transects. 1, 2, 3, got a bit confused there. I selected several transects. How I selected these transects, I first draw some vertical lines, and then I selected randomly one point, and I extended it until it crosses the vertical lines. But this, so here we have clusters of points. Yeah. Another example of a random sample. Two-stage random sample. So what I did here, I divided my area into blocks. Then I selected randomly some of these blocks. And then within these blocks, I selected points. That also gives you clusters of points, but in a different way. So then these are the basic sampling design types. And then there are many more types. Many, many, many more. So there are many possibilities of selecting a probability sample. So for validation, I evaluated these basic types of sampling design on the basis of simplicity, of selecting the locations, of the design, how simple is it to estimate this mean error, mean squared error, and so on, the precision of the estimates, costs, and validity. And well, looking at all these pluses and minuses, my conclusion was that the stratified simple random sampling might be a good idea. Yeah? Not so much the systematic random sampling. There is a minus over here. And well, it depends on how large your area is, whether these strategies, the cluster random sampling and the two-stage random sampling, are attractive options. If you want to validate a map of the whole world, a global map, maybe I do not like to have validation points everywhere over the globe. It's a lot of traveling. Maybe if I arrive in some country in Africa, then I would like to collect more validation sample there in that area. So maybe it's a good idea to cluster your validation points in that case. Whereas if your study area is very small, like I showed you this study area here in the Netherlands is very small, and travel time is no issue. So then it may be a good idea to spread out the validation locations throughout the area. Mm-hmm. So this is Ethiopia again. This was a map of solanogenic carbon predicted by regression kriging. And these are the predictions. Now I want to validate this map. Well, what are the options? This is a simple random sample. Well, that can be done, but I think it can be, there are better options. An alternative would be is to construct strata. And these strata, they are based on the predictions. So actually what I did, I used this map to define the strata. So I selected some values, for instance, quantiles in the frequency distribution of the predicted solanogenic carbon. For instance, if I want to have 5 strata, then I compute the 20 percentile, the 40 percentile, 60 and 80 percentile. And these values, these define the strata. And then you obtain 5 strata. Yeah? And then I do not know how many strata I have here, something like that. So these are the strata. And then you select randomly, fully randomly, for instance, simple random sampling, some pixels, some points within each stratum. Yeah? So another option would be to use your soil type map for stratification. If you have predicted the soil type by a classification tree, for instance, then you can use these predicted soil types as your strata. There's no problem with that. It's still a probability sample. So this gives you this sample. So now I have in every stratum defined by these quantiles some points. So now how to estimate the mean error or the mean squared error? I focus now on the mean squared error. Once you have collected your data, your validation data, then the question is how to estimate this mean squared error. Well, for simple random sampling, this is all very straightforward. Then you simply compute the squared errors at all validation points, and then you compute the average. And that is an unbiased estimate of the mean squared error. But for stratified simple random sampling, this is slightly more difficult, and that's why I would like to explain that. Yeah? So how to estimate the mean squared error for stratified simple random sampling. STSI means stratified simple random sampling. Well, it is this the mean squared error, and there is a hat on it. This hat means estimated mean squared error. Yeah? We must estimate it because we never know the true population mean squared error. We must estimate it from our validation sample. It's a weighted average of the estimated mean squared errors per stratum. This is the estimated mean squared error of stratum H. And we have L of these strata. In our case, 5. L is 5. So you first estimate the mean squared error at the level of the strata, and then you multiply them by some weight, and then you add them. And these weights, they are actually the relative area of these strata. So a large stratum will get a large weight, and a small stratum will get a small weight. This AH is the size of the area, or the number of pixels. So how to estimate the mean squared error at the level of the strata? Well, we have a simple random sample within a stratum. So at the level of the strata, we can simply compute the unweighted average of the squared errors. Yeah? So you have NH. So these are the number of points in a stratum. You have NH of these squared errors, yeah? You sum them and you divide them by NH. That's the sample average of the squared average. Yeah? This is an unbiased estimate of the mean squared error within the stratum. Yeah? So be aware that if you would simply compute the unweighted sample average of all squared errors, so if you do not account for the stratification, then you will get a biased estimate of the population mean squared error. Yeah? If you would compute the average of the squared errors for over all sampling points, you do not account for in which stratum these are, then this sample average will be a biased estimate of your population mean squared error. You must account for the stratum weights. This is a way to account for the different inclusion probabilities. Because some strata might have a larger sampling density than other strata. Yeah? So, as I said, I also would like to estimate the variance of these estimated mean squared errors. So how precise, how accurate is my estimate of the mean squared error? Well, we can estimate this variance. Actually, this is a sampling variance. Well, that's almost the same formula as for the mean. It's again a sum of the variances of the mean squared errors at the level of the strata. But now you do not multiply them by the weight, but by the squared weight. So there is a squared weight here. And how to estimate these variance of the estimated means at the level of the strata? Well, we have a simple random sample within a stratum, so then you can use this well-known formula. It's simply the variance, the population of the variance of the squared errors within the stratum divided by the number of points. There is an exercise on this, so that I hope then by doing this exercise, I hope that you will remember this all. when you are back. That would be nice. Then I have some final remarks. What time is it? 5:14. Oh, great. Yeah. Some remarks on accessibility. Many soil scientists think that this probability sampling is problematic in practice. I admit that there are problems, but I also think that there are many solutions for these problems, but you must be aware of them. And one of these problems is accessibility. Some areas depicted on your soil map may be very difficult to access, very remote areas, mountainous areas, and so on. How to deal with that? I think this is one of the big problems. And so I have prepared a few slides on that. I think it's important to account for that. It does not make sense to say, well, I ignore this practical problem and I do not account for this accessibility, because then you might end up with a sample with many sampling locations in very difficult areas which are very inaccessible. And so you have to deal with that. But there are solutions for that. You have to account for that. And in doing so, you can increase the efficiency of your design. And I think that there are many ways of dealing with this. Many sampling designs are available. One solution is very straightforward solution. The first option I would think of is referred to as selecting locations with probabilities proportional to size, in which the size measure is the accessibility. This is what we call PPS sampling. This size is a bit strange word here, but it stands for accessibility in this case. Let me show. This is somewhere in China. I was in China last year for several months. And so this is a real world area. And they said, and they had a map of this area. And they said to me, we cannot go here. Yeah, it's impossible. It's somewhere in the Himalaya or something. And then I said to them, well, if it's entirely impossible to go there, you should show it on the map. So that I know I did not validate the entire map, I validated this part of the map. Then we all know. But you should be clear about it. Which part of the map is validated? The entire map? Or did you exclude some areas? But then you should delineate these areas which are excluded from the probability sampling. And then these colors, they show the accessibility. It's scaled from 0 to 1. So these are the roads. Very windy roads, by the way. So very accessible, close to the road, and this was a really simple accessibility model, but it's to illustrate how it works. And the further away, the less accessible. And now I will select by random sampling locations with probabilities proportional to this accessibility. On the next slide. So these are the points that I've selected. And the larger the circles, the more accessible. So you see many sampling points with large circles. These are really easy to access. But you also have some points over there, for instance, which is pretty hard to access. But there are only a few of them. Yeah? And of course, if you have these data, these sample data, and you want to estimate the mean error and the mean squared error, then you have to take these different inclusion probabilities into account. I will not explain now how this can be done, but that can be read in our book or in many textbooks on sampling. You have many estimators for that. And you can still estimate the variance. You will have an unbiased estimate of your mean squared error and the mean error, and of the variance of this mean error and mean squared error. Yeah? So this is one solution. Conclusions, calibration mapping. And validation ask for different sampling strategies, and consequently validation by additional sampling is superior to validation by data splitting or cross validation. And if you choose for additional sampling, then I would recommend probability sampling. Yeah. And the nice thing that if you have a probability sample, then you can obtain an unbiased estimate of the mean error, mean squared error, and so on, even when the prediction errors show spatial structure, let me say. With this I mean, if you have a large error over here, then there will also be a large error at a very nearby location. But in probability sampling, this is not a problem. And it's important to think of these map quality measures, think of it as population parameters. So the mean squared error is similar to the mean soil organic carbon content. You replace soil organic carbon content by squared error, but it's a population mean, and you want to estimate the population mean, not of the population mean of a soil property, but the population mean of errors or of squared errors. And you will never know it without error, but you can estimate it, and you want to have an unbiased estimate of it. And with probability sampling, you can estimate these population parameters model-free by design-based inference. You can also quantify your uncertainty about these estimates. And you can obtain an unbiased estimate of the variance. And if you have an estimate of the mean error and of the variance of the mean error, you can statistically test, for instance, the null hypothesis that the mean error is zero, that you do not have bias.